Okay, good evening. I'd like to call the DEI committee meeting to order. In attendance, we have Brian Heffer, myself. A motion to approve the agenda.
Yeah, motion to approve.
Second. And passes. Public comments. We have a public comment request from Linda Ashmore.
You can just come up to the white table and speak.
This is just a brief public comment, since I know this meeting's kind of long, but I want to thank the DEI committee and the school district for flying the pride flag and the mental health flag, especially after what happened in Texas and what you're going to be discussing tonight. Mental health is huge. And I think kind of recognizing and providing support to some of the marginalized communities really makes a difference. So that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
We also had one public comment that was sent in by email. So we don't need to read that, but we just acknowledge that we did receive it and it was sent to the community and the whole board.
Okay, that brings us to reports and follow up with the district student service team.
I can do a quick introduction and then I'll let you kind of introduce our whole team that's here. So first of all, at the last DEI meeting we had the administration from the high school and middle school here. And that was really a follow-up to the school board's communications with some of our student groups at the high school. And one of the pieces that was discussed at that point was, well, what happens when there's an incident that happens at school? What kind of follow-up takes place? So we felt the best place for that conversation to occur was with the folks who are working closely with some of those decisions and those processes. I think after that meeting, it was also discussed that it would be then also beneficial for this committee and the community to also hear, in addition to what's happening from an administrative level, what's happening from a support perspective with all of our students. And this is the team that really takes a big leadership role in working with their kids. And so Chris Mann is here with all members of the student services team. So it may just be just for kind of the edification of the board and for anyone here, just to kind of hear who all of you are. That's okay, Chris. And just start off with kind of introducing yourselves as far as our staff who are here, kind of what your position is in the district and where you work. So that gives you an idea of kind of who our audience is. And as we have some discussion tonight, we may be kind of bringing some of those conversations and we welcome you to that discussion.
So we have our secondary student services here, as well as our secondary SCL coaches. So one, we'll start with Jenny, and you can introduce yourself and your role in your buildings.
My name is Jenny Topol. I'm the school psychologist for the Wanakee Middle School, grades 7 and 8.
I'm Ty Jerry, middle school counselor.
I'm Rose Nather. I'm the social worker at the high school and also the SCL coach at the high school.
Courtney O'Brien, one of the two school psychologists at the high school.
Christy Sheffelman, I'm the school social worker at the TLC building.
I'm Jessica Main. I'm a district-wide social worker, but I am the HWA prevention coordinator for the district, the homeless liaison, and the 4K social worker, but I work with high school and middle school students.
I'm Kelly Bratz. I'm a 7th grade ELA teacher and SEL coach for middle school.
I'm Samantha Pilsner. I am middle school Spanish teacher and middle school and external SEL coach.
I'm Mark Landis, one of the counselors at the high school.
Melissa Backer, a counselor at the high school.
Megan Buffelman, counselor at the high school.
Sarah Steinmark, counselor at the high school.
Thank you. That's who we have today joining us.
So before we begin, I'd just like to thank all of you for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us tonight. It's really helpful for us. So thank you.
All yours, Chris.
It's all mine. All right, I'm going to get us started. So Rebecca, if you can pull up our PowerPoint. Let's see. Let's make sure this clicker works. It does not. So we'll try the next. There we go. That'll work. All right. So I'd like to start off with just sharing the DPI, Wisconsin School Mental Health Framework. I think this is a really good visual when we're looking at what does a comprehensive school mental health system look like. We know that mental wellness is really important and contributes to better learning outcomes for all of our students. So on the bottom of that pyramid, there's a foundational and the all. And that's a lot of what this committee has been talking about is around the SEL or the things we're doing to support all learners. have some noises going on. And what I also like about this visual is, in addition to those universal or those practices we do for all kids, you can kind of see going up the pyramid, there's a continuum of supports, and they're of different varying intensities and really like meeting our students where they're at. Some are going to be fine with those universal supports, some are going to need a little more, and a few are going to need even more. There we go. All right, so here's the different tiers and levels that I'm going to reference throughout the presentation this evening. And I'm going to also expand on these in a little bit as to what this looks like in Wanakee. But when we're talking about foundational and universal practices, a lot of that is what we do for all kids. It's relationship building, it's focusing on classroom and school building, community, positive culture and climate. It's those types of things that we do for all kids. When we move up to selected, that's really just giving another layer of support for some kids who need it. It's still very proactive. When we go into intensive, that's for those few kids that need even more of like a very individualized wraparound collaborative type approach, because they might need even more supports than the universal or the sum. So again, we'll come back to this and expand on this a little bit. But before we do that, I want to share a couple of things, just a few considerations I'd like you to keep in mind. So back in 2019, it was the same year of COVID, it was the 1920 school year, but it was before COVID, it was in the fall. We facilitated the mental health needs assessment at all six of our schools. And what we learned was that all six of the schools identified social emotional learning as a priority area. They all said we need to incorporate social emotional learning into our everyday work with kids. That was identified at all six schools. We formed a district-wide SEL committee, which then worked throughout the year and later made a recommendation to move forward with developmental designs. And you're going to hear more about that in a bit.
Chris, for these surveys to the students or parents?
The mental health needs assessment was school teams that went through a DPI tool to identify where we had solid systems and where we had some gaps.
Okay.
We also learned from that DPI mental health needs assessment that at the high school level, our high school teams really felt we needed more in that top part of the pyramid, that intense supports or partnerships, resources and interventions for kids who are really struggling. So that's another area we have been working on as well. I did hear from past DEI committees that you really wanted to know where our students are at. So I did link in some Dane County Youth Assessment data. This is from 2021. That was the last time we took it, was February of 2021. So we're in hybrid mode and kind of coming back from COVID. We also participated in the Youth Risk Behavior Survey this last fall. We don't have those results back yet. Both of these surveys are very similar in that they're asking kids to share about how they, traffic safety, nutrition, sleep, mental health, alcohol and drug use, they're very aligned. So I did include some data on the Dane County Youth Assessment to share where our kids are at. We also have information from our student screener, which is the SSIS SEL plus mental health. We've done the SSIS SEL for quite a few years, but in the past have asked teachers to fill it out about kids that might be having some SEL needs. This year, we wanted to go directly and get student voice. And we used their updated version that included the mental health component so that we would know if there were kids who were struggling with internalizing and externalizing type behaviors. So we'll share some of that data with you. We have staff feedback around our SEL efforts. Our SEL coaches have done a really great job focusing on building our staff capacity around social emotional learning, but then also giving our staff tools and resources they need to implement it in their classrooms. So we're gonna talk about where staff are at with their SEL work. And then just a reminder, I don't have any data points on this, but just a reminder that student social emotional learning has been identified by the district as part of your strategic plan for many years. And so this is not new. These are just things we're continuing to improve on and address the needs of our students. So I pulled a couple of things from the Dane County Youth Assessment that I felt related to what we're talking about this evening around SEL and around mental health. You can see those top three points that kids are struggling. More kids are struggling in the 2021 data than the 2018. The last point about the most important causes of stress and anxiety for our middle and high schoolers, that remained the same from 2018 to 2021. Those top two pieces have always been identified in the last few surveys as too much homework and pressure to perform in school, as what our Wanakee students are saying as the top stressors. going to have Courtney, our school psychologist at the high school, come up and talk a little bit about this SSIS, SEL plus mental health. The social skills improvement system is what it's called, and then the SEL plus mental health is the version we used this year. And we did this at grades 3, 5, 7, and 9. So I'll have Courtney share a little bit about what we learned.
All right, hello everyone. So this first slide is showing our response rate by our schools and for the whole district. And what we can see here is we had a range of 71% to 98% of response rates for students. And overall, as a district, our total response rate was 91%.
Let me know what
we put. This next slide here is showing our total social emotional learning performance across our buildings and as our whole district. Based on the student responses, they were categorized into 4 different areas. So emerging and developing is where they're advised to have more skill instruction in those areas. Competent is where we'd expect students to be at that level. And then advanced is above and beyond. And so we can see here that as a district, we had 88% of our students were in that competent or advanced range. So where they we expect them to be performing or above. And then we had 10% in developing and 2% in the emerging. And overall across school buildings there.
So is this based on per student or is this staff assessing their classes?
Students responded to the survey.
Student response, yep. Okay.
And then the additional skill instruction for social emotional learning, again, that was based off of the categories they're in. So if they're in developing or emerging, they were recommended for additional skill instruction. And we can see here the specific domains of the social emotional learning of where they were advised to have the additional skill instruction. And we can see that self-management was our largest one for the district, followed by self-awareness. And again, that was pretty consistent across our school buildings.
Can you define just for the board kind of what those two things mean, self-awareness and self-management?
Yeah, so self-awareness is being able to recognize your behavior and its impact on others and your emotional functioning, just kind of recognizing what that is an impact on others. And then self-management is that next step of being able to manage your behaviors and emotional responses. And this is students that were requiring follow-up. And this was specifically looking at the mental health portion of the screener. So if they were flagged as a possible concern or concern for both internalizing or externalizing concerns. In total, we identified 219 students that we followed up with across the district. And the range was from 5% to 22% across the school buildings.
And again, this was given at grades 3, 5, 7, 9. All right, thank you, Courtney. Now I'm going to have Rose and Kelly and Sam come up. I talked a little bit about the staff feedback on SEL, and these three are part of a team of coaches who have worked very hard to implement and help our teachers feel comfortable with their own SEL as well as delivering it in the classroom. So I'm going to have them share a bit about the SEL feedback we received from staff.
So again, this is staff reporting just on kind of their experience with SEL. And I, like Chris mentioned, the SEL internal coaches as a team kind of created a foundational survey, and then we altered it a little bit for our buildings, but it was asking all the same questions. So you can see how important do you feel it is to implement social emotional practices into our learning spaces, and the overwhelming majority of teachers recognize that it feels very important.
And the next question was, implementing social emotional learning has a positive impact on my students, and again, you can see there that the majority of staff either strongly agreed or agreed quite significantly that it is something that is helping students, the work that we've been doing.
Next is one goal that I have around social emotional learning is, so overwhelmingly the majority of staff feel the need to connect SEL competencies to their everyday work with students. And when we were talking about this in our coaches meeting, we talked about not just having it be like a standalone. We all have advisory or circle time or connect time, but that it's really not just like the standalone time that is scheduled in our day, but really making sure that it's embedded in the ways that we support students in our classes, maybe even in the lunchroom. So really focusing on different ways that we can focus all around. But then the next highest goal that staff indicated was learning and utilizing developmental designs approaches. So again, seeing that need for developmental designs training among our staff, followed by, again, understanding both like the DPI SEL competencies as well as CASEL, which are kind of intertwined and connected.
Nice question. Mm-hmm. All right, so at the middle school and high school, this is, in terms of your teaching staff as a whole, it's primarily how they work with students and respond to what they perceive are needs. At the elementary level, there's a more of an instructional piece. Is there some of that at the middle high school too, through the advisory time, et cetera, or is that just, is it more how you're working with them?
I would say for, we do have advisory where at times we'll build things in, and then at the middle school we do something called Warrior Way Wednesday, is where we'll specifically do some lessons targeting specific either expectations, reminders, or just some different social emotional learning needs. Guidance does come in and present as well. So that would be more of the explicit, but like I think this survey is really like the whole staff perspective on what they personally can do for their classrooms.
Thank you.
It's pretty similar at high school too. High school.
And then the next was, when growing in my learning around SEL, I prefer the following. So looking at this, professional development days during those PD days, as opposed to professional development opportunities outside the workday. So when we're planning those PD days, making that a focus. And then when you look at the next two, I guess highest, sharing information and resources, either during staff meetings or through email, which does align with kind of what we've done this year. A big part of our focus has been, at least at the middle school, once a month, presenting to our staff and then sharing out those various resources that they can utilize.
Seems like your PLC, it looks like you'd like to do a lot in the PLC. I would think that's the place to do it.
And we talked about that a lot, actually. We were talking about our summer groups. The PLCs is, you know, our summer group will get together the summer, kind of plan next year. And PLCs are, you know, a ready set group of shared curriculum. And so it just, it feels like a really natural way to kind of start incorporating SEL work. So yeah, we recognize that as well.
Yeah, one thing we talked about was when you're looking at like a curricular unit, if you know, for example, you have students that are going to be working together in groups on a project, maybe focusing on relationship skills would naturally kind of tie in together, but really focusing on, again, not in your PLC, on building that capacity.
This data is pretty new, and so we're using this for our summer planning, but for next year, we're going to continue to move this work forward.
Great, thank you. You'll be back up soon. Yeah. All right, so now I want to take it back to that pyramid. And we have the universal practices. And so I want to talk a little bit about how this looks in Wanakee. What kinds of things are we doing at universal levels for all students? And positive behavior interventions and supports, PBIS. I know many of you have heard of that. It's been around for a very long time. That is really teaching those behavior expectations. So we're teaching kids what our expectations are for behavior on the bus, in the lunchroom, in the bathroom, in the hallways. That's that focus that we really spend time on, especially in the beginning of the year, but also throughout the year, especially this year coming back after being home in a hybrid. So that's PBIS. Then there's the trauma-sensitive approaches. This has been around in Wanakee probably for 5 or 6 years. We had a few trainers who trained the entire district. It did kind of fizzle out. We are revamping. We're getting new people trained. We'll have a trainer in each building. And we're reigniting that work, the trauma sensitive. When I think about trauma sensitive, I think about acknowledging that there is a higher prevalence of trauma these days. We know that trauma can impact the developing brain. So what can we do in our everyday interactions to help kids heal that are impacted by trauma, and just practices that are good for all kids. So a lot of that ties into some of this other work we're doing, but it's a focusing on relationships and regulation and offering choice, collaboration, previewing change, if we have upcoming changes for kids, having a preview of that, using verbal de-escalation techniques. That is a technique as well that's trauma sensitive. So really being comfortable in integrating that into our teaching every day. We had the opportunity to learn from Dr. Ross Green, and many of our schools have actually done book studies on Dr. Ross Green. He reminds us that kids do well if they can. And if they're not doing well, what is the reason for that? What is the underlying behavior? Are there lagging skills we need to teach to? Are there other barriers to learning? What can we, how can we find out about what is the issue? What is the underlying issue? He also reminds us that behavior is a form of communication. So if we can dig down and find out a little bit more about what is going on, and he gives us some tools that we can use the student services to kind of work through that with problem solving teams, that will help us move forward with identifying the barrier to learning and address the issue. Community circles, connect time, advisory, all of those are part of those relationship building, connectedness, sense of belonging. A lot of that falls under developmental designs and that approach that we've been talking a little bit about. And as a universal practice, we also have those screeners that we just learned about, the SSIS. We do that in grades 3, 5, 7, 9, which helps us understand where our kids are at with those DPI social emotional competencies, as well as any mental health concerns. We talk a lot about SEL, and I think sometimes there's maybe a misunderstanding of what SEL is. This is a definition from the Collaborative for Academic Social and Emotional Learning, or CASEL. And so this is a long definition. I'm not going to read this, but I can summarize it in two words. It's people skills. That's really what SEL is, it's people skills. This also gets a little murky. You probably heard CASEL domains, and you've heard DPI, social emotional competencies, and what do these all mean? So the Collaborative for Academic Social and Emotional Learning, which is CASEL, they have a framework that identifies 5 domains, and those are listed here: relationship skills, social awareness, self-awareness, self-management, responsible decision-making. And then a few years ago, DPI was like, well, we're releasing our social emotional competencies, and they are, and they listed these 3: emotional development, self-concept, and social competence. Not the same as CASEL domains. However, what we do know is those 5 CASEL domains are incorporated into those 3 DPI competencies that they have. And then developmental design sometimes gets confusing too. People think that's a curriculum, and it's really not. It's an approach. It's focusing on how we teach teachers to teach, incorporating relationships and focusing on connectedness and engagement with our kids. That's really what developmental design is. SEL is not new to Wanakee. We've had SEL around for some time. I believe it was called Character Education years ago. And I think the district also utilized Tribes, which is an SEL curriculum. And then community circles have been around for a while. And I think it was you, Randy, who shared Education for Employment was a class maybe that we offered.
It's one of the 10 standards at DPI. Anyone I was teaching, you had to identify where in your curriculum did you teach Education for Employment, which was working together, relationships, all those type of things. So to me, that kind of fits into the people skills piece that we're talking
about. Absolutely. And so now it's just shifted a little. Now, if you think of SEL, it's aligning more with the mental wellness piece and kind of viewed as like a behavior management toolbox for teachers. So it's just shifted a little, but it still has the pieces about building college and career ready kids. It gives them those life skills, those people skills that are so important.
So one of the things I think, you know, obviously, if we're teaching SEL in high school, we've probably lost it, you know, from the standpoint. But, you know, it's a learned behavior, right? Or at least in my mind. You know, do we put more emphasis on elementary, you know, as far as teaching, you know, these skills? And then it's kind of monitoring and coaching, you know, in the rest of the year. So,
well, that was a perfect segue for the next slide, because I threw it in the elementary examples. We do start young. And we did our summer SEL coaches last summer, looked at how is our timeline going to look? How are we going to roll this out to make sure we cover all the domains starting in kindergarten? And you can see we listed the SEL or the CASEL domains, and then those DPI standards and competencies under. And so we did focus on each of those domains throughout the year at the K-4 level. And really work to build that within our elementary kids. And I think we need to, we're going to see this for years. We have to build those skills so that when they get older, they have those castle domains down. They're figuring out self-awareness and self-management. So starting young is important. And then I will have my middle and high school SEL coaches return to share a little bit. We had our timeline as well. The middle high school things kind of went a little differently, but I'll have them share a little bit about what we did.
So I will go first, and I do want to address how you talked about, like, do we need to keep doing this? Should we have to keep doing this as they get older? And I think what you find, at least I can speak to middle school, is that the different problems that kids face change and get tougher. And you think of the social expectations and the peer relationships and how those develop is kind of reason why we have to continue to go back to this. And as they grow and develop, they're, you know, kind of having different emotions and hormones and all that in middle school, especially that, you know, help teaching them those management is really important. So what we found, we had created, this was our summer work from last year, where we had developed this plan, but then we surveyed our staff at the beginning of the year, and we realized that they didn't really feel like they fully understood the castle domains well enough for us to just push forward with the, you know, lessons targeted on those specific domains. So we ended up taking a back step, and we asked staff if we could just present at one staff meeting a month about each of the domains. We didn't quite get through all of them, but we do feel like that was the right step. And we are going to ask for time at the very beginning of the next year to do a refresher, because every year we have new staff. And so we want to make sure that we always get people familiar with what they need to know, so then we can push forward with those, like we said, the PLC meetings and getting staff discussing how they can incorporate it into their everyday teaching.
So then at the high school, we kind of followed this timeline. And we also, we tried to match kind of the SEL skill to where, or the competency, I'm sorry, to where we were in the school year. So in September, you're building relationships, you're meeting new peers. So really focusing on relationship skills. Then in January and February, when, you know, things get really challenging, especially the finals at the high school, thinking about self-awareness, which really focuses on anxiety and stress management. So at the high school, like Kelly said, at the middle school, really the focus was on making sure that our teachers are aware of each competency and feel comfortable with it. So we would take a little bit of time at our staff meetings to just define the competency. Sometimes we had staff do a little activity. Sometimes we had teachers present. So for instance, for relationship skills, there was one teacher in the math department who does something special when she does groups, or I guess the whole math department, when they do groups, they assign roles. And that's really a castle skill, is when you're working in a group, what's your role and how do you interact with each other? And so she presented at a staff meeting. And I think that was really powerful, was teachers hearing and seeing and learning from each other. And then we would, all of our advisory times would also kind of center around that castle domain. So we were subtly teaching kids, like, oh, we're going to talk about relationship skills and build relationship skills for the first few months. So this is kind of how we moved through the year. I will admit things got, of course, a little looser and busier as we went on. But we really just tried to keep the focus for everyone on this, the castle domain, and this is what it means, really at like a very surface level.
So when you look at these marks, and I think, you know, we heard that as we went from club to club, you know, the clubs are starting to work together or do projects together. How in this whole development here that you put together, how do you get those kids to, you know, come together and talk? You know, because, you know, and I think I've said it a number of times, I think what we've been doing, you know, through COVID, is we've been talking at each other, we're not talking with each other to solve problems. So how does this get integrated into those type of activities? Because I think we've got some pretty sharp kids, and there are certain kids that are reaching across the aisle. You know, how do you reinforce that?
That's a great question, and something that I think I've been
thinking a lot. Give us a great answer.
I practiced that answer. Something that internal coaches have been talking a lot about is, you know, first we had to make sure our staff was really comfortable with the competencies and all the skills. And now we feel like our staff has a really good understanding. So how do we not only include students in this work so that they're teaching each other, but then so they can come together, like you said. So that's future work. I know at the high school, currently advisory lessons are planned by the adults. I would love if students could start planning advisory lessons, and if some of the advisory lessons could be discussions between groups, or between, you know, opposite sides of the aisle. So that's coming. And I think that that's the exciting work. You know, talking to adults is great.
So is that next year, or is it 2 years? You know, how do we accelerate this so that, you know, we can move this forward?
I would say two to three years.
How do we do it in the next 1 or 2?
If you want kids interacting, we want to talk through some, have candid conversations. I think that the art of leading a circle, mm-hmm. and being able to have prompts that get kids talking and having it in a safe place, is one way. And so having our teachers comfortable with the domains and comfortable with prompts and things that they can ask in engaging ways, keeping kids engaged to open up that conversation, and if kids feel safe and supported, I think we'll see more of those discussions happening. Right now, I think some of our teachers are nervous about leading those kind of discussions around self-management or self-awareness if they don't fully understand it themselves. So we're going to continue to build staff capacity while we're giving them the tools and resources and prompts or things that they can do, activities in their classroom, to get the kids talking. And same with groups, same with sports, like pulling it all together, get teachers comfortable in leading this work and integrating it into their everyday work with kids. So it takes time.
And really, so many of these competencies it's all interconnected. I mean, I think about kids have to have such fine-tuned self-awareness and self-management skills to have those difficult conversations, right? They need to be able to manage their own emotions as well as relate to somebody with different emotions or different thoughts and opinions. So I feel like our first step is really mastering these skills, and then that kind of those discussions come naturally.
And I was just going to add that, like, if the more we can build it into our classrooms, just with, you know, I think of when I do book clubs, and this is new after, you know, the training I've had, we have the kids create their own norms for their meetings. So they talk about, you know, what is expected, what do we expect of each other in terms of preparation? How will we respond to each other when we disagree? And getting them to practice some of those skills in the classroom, I think can then help us to get to that point where, you know, can carry into the clubs and give them the skills they need to have those more difficult conversations. It's a great example of how we incorporate SEL into our learning. So you've heard a lot about Universal. I'm going to briefly talk a little bit about the next two tiers, the selected practices and support. So I know I listed that screener we did, the SSIS, as a Universal practice, but we have kids who have flagged on that. So we need to follow up and offer support for families and students who have flagged either with the mental health or maybe just overall social emotional. So that can be a selected practices and supports. Here's some examples of some things we might do with students and help support students and families. The check-in, check-out piece you've probably heard a lot about is mostly affiliated, I would say, with PBIS. However, it also can be more of a cognitive behavior type technique or skill that we might use with kids in the student services world. So really working on some of that SEL or mental health piece. We do individual work with kids. We do small groups with kids. That's something as student services staff, we are comfortable doing. And we have sometimes pulled in a FACE kids therapist to co-facilitate groups with us. And that's gone very well as well.
What's the process of how you, who recognizes the issue and starts bringing it to the team to be able to put a plan together for that student? Is it usually the teacher in the classroom? Is it the office that sees the student?
It could be multiple reasons. Okay. Like our referrals, probably, correct me if I'm wrong, could come from families themselves, from students themselves, from teachers noticing things, from attendance, from frequent behaviors to the health room. It's a team approach. So during our student services teams, we're hearing and talking about kids. Our nurses involved saying, you know, I've seen this kid down there every day. Oh, it looks like it's during math every day. You know, so we can problem solve that way and work together.
How often does a parent call in and say, hey, just want you to be aware?
Well, that's okay. How often do you have family referrals of parents calling in? Yeah, sure, since COVID, it's gone.
It's good.
Yeah.
We use the data from the SSIS, the screener that she mentioned. So we would combine our names and data for different data. Sometimes front groups are from the screener data as well.
This year, we also utilized some grant money to bring in a clinician at our high school to do some drop-in learning opportunities around mental wellness topics and also do some staff consultation. She worked heavily at the TLC supporting our students as well. So that's been wonderful. And we, you know, we facilitate emotional regulation plans and we work collaboratively with families and outside providers as well. And then that last year, where a few kids land where they need more intensive supports. This is usually very individualized, very much a collaboration with students, families, and typically community providers. I think of it as more of like a wrapping around that kid, a wraparound service. So some examples of this would be like safety planning. So this year we've done 80 plus suicide risk assessments. And 60% of them are middle and high schoolers, but 40% are K-6. And our youngest one was first grade this year. So we have kids who are struggling. And when we do a suicide risk assessment, that usually will follow up with a safety plan. Reentry plans, this could be for kids who are coming back from inpatient treatment, or it could be for a kid coming back after experiencing a traumatic event, and we need to have support in place for that student to come back. We have Building Bridges Now, which is a partnership program with Dane County Human Services and Catholic Charities. They have let us pilot referring ninth graders this year, and they're gonna give us another year to pilot ninth grade so we can refer our freshmen for that program. Sometimes we've brought in behavior consultants. We've had student services staff members. We have a handful of them trained in ESPERT. And then most of you know we have a partnership with Psychotherapy Center of Wanakee this year to help if we have any families that have barriers to getting therapy services for their kids, that we can have access, they can have access to that throughout the day.
Have you used, Richie Davis at the University of Skeptic Mindfulness? Have you looked at any of that? Kind of meditation, are you guys working with that?
I am not familiar that we are utilizing that, but I would open that up. Are we using mindfulness?
At the high school and our advisors, we've incorporated some mindfulness practices, especially when we were virtual and hybrid, little like breathing exercises. There is a website that I'm now completely clicking on, Healthy Minds, that has mindfulness activities. And actually a lot of teachers at the high school, I've noticed that seems to be the most commonly incorporated kind of practice across the board, is to just taking just a minute to breathe at the beginning of class or a pause in the middle of class. So I guess, yes, but I would be curious about that.
Well, Richie Davison said the university, mm-hmm. We used him in the military for PTSD, which traumatic stress disorder, just to cool the body. Just kind of relax. And I think he's got a center on West University. It'd be kind of interesting. Healthy Minds is Richie's.
So that's the one you're talking about, Ross?
Yeah.
How long do these intensive supports usually? Do you find them that they're continuous in an individual, or you find more there's an acute issue in the last couple of months?
I think I'll speak from my experience. It depends, right? If we have if we're doing suicide risk assessments and we have a safety plan, we're going to want to revisit that frequently, and that'll probably be a student on our radar for at least 6 months. Building Bridges referrals, like we kind of keep an eye on who we want to refer, and then we're in partnership. That's a 90-day wraparound program, so that would move on. But we might take on some of that responsibility then after Building Bridges closes, and we're continuing to put some supports in place as well. So it really is student-dependent and issue-dependent as well.
And you're working with families through all this?
Through all of it.
Where they feel comfortable, whether it's
families that have to grant consent
or somewhere outside.
Warm handoffs to providers, especially if there's mental health concerns. All right, I'm going to have Ty come up and talk a little bit about some training opportunities. We as student services have a lot of opportunities, and we know that building a culture, climate, and safe environment for all our learners is is important. And so we've had some opportunities that we've offered to district have been part of organizing and facilitating. So I'm gonna have Ty talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, a lot of these have been mentioned throughout the slides, but just a little bit more. We talked a lot about our staff building capacity and building comfort around having those different conversations that they're used to outside their content. So developmental design, we started doing a couple years ago. It was virtually trained the first summer for a group of us, and then some more staff did it last summer. I believe last I saw, it's going to be in the fall PD calendar put out for staff to be doing some more training with them next fall in October, so that we'll get a wider range of people trained on that, and we'll continue to lead those advisories and try to embed those skills through that developmental designs program. Ross Green, we had a chance to work with again, kind of mentioned in some book studies, and have been able to use a few of those examples of his trainings with some of our individual students and have some collaborative time kind of work on those skills. The SRA we just mentioned, we were just in our staff development meeting last Monday. We actually did a review, kind of revise of the SRA, and kind of went through some of those practices with our own group to make sure we were aligning our groups together, making sure we follow procedures the same way for every school. Adolescent and youth mental health, that I feel like that was
the last couple summers.
I was gonna say, there's been a lot. Yeah.
Department of Justice, Stewart Safety Grant.
The MVCI has been around for a while. We have somebody trained in each building, and that's continually offered training for students and students for staff around different techniques to help students in different situations. Percy Brown came in twice, I believe, and did presentations for us at the staff development level. And we've had some continual conversations about having more involvement with him. The Speak Up at Schools, we were trained on that as a group and started putting that out to staff as the different ways to have conversations and put things out verbally when situations arise and have again more comfortable conversations with students and different techniques instead of kind of avoiding things that happen. And then trauma sensitive schools has been, again, we're going to have more trainings that we've kind of revived that again, and we're going to have more people trained in that as we go forward. We kind of have those approaches. Again, just a toolbox of different ideas and techniques that we can all kind of use, not just student services, but more and more staff as we go forward.
So I think this is more for you, Chris and Ty, but this is a lot, right? And it's happened over time and some's repeated. How do we integrate our beginning teachers and our new veteran teachers? So, I mean, some of the veterans may have some of the programs. I doubt that they have all of them. So where does that, I saw like for PLC, there looks like a big thing happening this summer to revisit that. But so what about these things?
So a lot of this, so like our trauma sensitive schools, we're revamping. So we have reps from each building. So then we work as a team, similar to SEL.
Right.
We plan over the summer, and then they go to their buildings and deliver it during staff meetings or get it out during PLCs or incorporate it that way. The suicide risk assessment is kind of, we view as part of now, especially since COVID, part of our like annual trainings we need to do. They see the suicide risk assessment, we're mandated to read every year from DPI, but our student services like to go above and beyond it and make sure that just like child abuse prevention and mandated reporting that we're talking about, how do you handle if you have a child with suicidal ideation? What do you do after hours, during hours? So we go through that every year as training. A lot of these things like developmental designs is during, it will be during a PD day or it's during summer training. Speak Up at Schools, again, and Percy Brown is more district-wide, but we're integrating it through our staff meetings and through the building level by having reps and a team approach, somebody from each building. So,
thank you.
Have you ever tracked the number of these emails regarding this that are open or not opened?
Percent.
Okay. Because I know, I mean, training in person is great or like that, yeah. But when you're inundated with parent emails and district emails.
We try to incorporate a lot of this into our back to school work. So like MVCI, that focusing on de-escalation, going through nonviolent crisis, we do that with new teachers or new staff in August. And then we offer refreshers throughout the year that our trainers do, or they'll bring it to their staff meetings. And so yes, we try to incorporate it at the building level as much, because I think if it's too many district things, or we might do a district PD and then have the follow-up be in the buildings.
Yeah,
well, so, go ahead. No, go ahead.
Well, to go back many slides, you know, I mean, I was like, when we're saying that SEL is beneficial, why would there be a one and two? Have you heard reasons why? Well, we really don't need to do this in our school, or we don't really think it's beneficial, or are they saying it's not beneficial the way we're trying to run the program?
Or we don't have time to incorporate.
Yeah, so, you know, is it, we know it's beneficial, but we don't have the right information to do it yet.
Yeah, and I defer to some of our coaches too to make sure I have this, but I'm thinking we didn't have the buy-in from staff. Staff didn't understand SEL enough, I think, until recently to understand how it's beneficial or why it's beneficial. So seeing that those numbers way over on the right like that was reassuring, because now we know we have staff buy-in. So then what are our next steps to continue with that?
Yeah, it's so closely tied to academic learning.
Right.
If you can function with
yes.
people
yes.
and feel comfortable with them, then it translates over to
But not everybody was there. Not everybody understood
right.
SEL. They thought it was one more thing, but truly it ties into everyday teaching practices and best practices.
The worst thing we do in education is we label everything.
Yeah,
we put a name
true.
To it. You start doing PLCs, which is group work. You start doing SEL, which is something we've done for generations. It's how do you relate to people? How do you get along with people? How do you work together? It's things that we do in our clubs, in sports teams, in the classroom. It's all the same. We just put a label to it.
Right.
And then there has a framework that's built around it that we use to make sure we train people. So to me, that's part of, I think, what some of that is, Brian, is it's like, well, there's another initiative. Well, it's, yes, it's kind of entitled to it, but it's really kind of what we, it's what we talk about. And this is a diversion. I asked all of our new teachers, who's your favorite teacher? That have them talk about it during our first day of school. And it's always about someone who they connected with. It's rarely ever about because this person was able to describe this algorithm perfectly. It was because they connected with me and they helped me, they motivated me, they inspired me. That's all SEL stuff. How do we connect with kids? And that's, I think, part of it is just trying, now that we put a label to it, it seems like it's something else. And then it's trying to just kind of make sure that we're doing some of those pieces. And as Chris said, and yeah, there are some things that we're asking folks to do that are some additional things, but they're part of being a good and effective instructor.
If someone's training online, you know, like cybersecurity training, you know, you get companies out there, you go through for 20 minutes, cybersecurity training, phishing email, you know, all that kind of stuff. Is some of this stuff, you know, can we get some type of program where, you know, get it out? And then to your point, you know that people have opened it and they've actually looked at it. You know, is there a process like that out there, or a program out there, or have you seen it?
Now, by like crisis, it's blended learning when people are doing some online work and then come together for the practice part of it. I'm not sure. I'm not aware. I know like our DPI requires mandated reporting training every 5 years as an online program you do, and then we verify as a district. But a lot of this is in person or virtual trainings that we do personalized and specific to Wanakee.
Some of it is, there's definitely things, Jack, that we push out there that are video based. There's also things that we kind of put out there that are kind of really big parts of what we do. And then we're also looking at kind of what's the research on how do adults learn? How do you support adult learning and professional development? Some of it you can do via electronic means, but some of your best things are tied into in-person pieces. So sometimes it's a blend, sometimes it's one or the other, depending on what the
Yeah, I just sort of think, you know, after you do a professional development face-to-face, you know, every week or so, if it's something you're really focusing on this quarter, just even a question for the teacher, one email, how, you know, so they think at top of mind.
Okay, that's right.
It doesn't have to be a long email, just a scenario or a thought or something like that. But I get it.
They do have that. DPI does use that actually for trauma sensitive schools. You can go through the modules, and then every so often they do ask you a question. I think there's a threat assessment and safety piece that is online if we wanted to use the DPI modules for our source of trauma sensitive schools training. And perhaps we might use some kind of modular online piece as part of the work we do as trauma sensitive team.
Well, in conversations with some of the staff, I feel like they don't want to remind the teacher next door that this is how we're supposed to do it. That's not their job. Well, when you only have two administrators and three in a building, you sort of have to work together to remind, hey, this is our policy on this. You know, I mean, I know that you don't want to hold them accountable, but without that, you're not. It's like kids. You want a kid to tap the other one and say, you know, okay, one of them's learned and he just learned not to do it. You know, so it's a reminder. So I, you know, I've sat through a lot of professional development too. And yeah, if it's not popped up on a month later, it's probably out of my mind.
Couple slides left. The last one is, what is our future work? Thank you, Ted. And so I'm super proud of our student services. And I know this is just secondary. We have a whole larger team out there. We have done a lot of great things around addressing some of those concerns or areas of growth that came up during that mental health needs assessment. And especially during COVID, navigating a lot of different things has been challenging. So we have a lot of great partnerships going on. We have a lot of great work going on. So next year's focus is to really tie all this together. It's probably time for another needs assessment. It's time to look at our mental health referral pathways. It's time to look at our sustainability because our needs are increasing. Our student services needs are increasing. Our kids are needing more help. And so how do we make sure we have a comprehensive school mental health program that will address the needs of all of our learners? So we do have next year, we're using grant money to send a team of people to the Comprehensive School Mental Health Academy, sponsored by DPI and ASA. And so we will have a group of probably 9 or 10, one from each school at least, an SEL coach and myself and a couple principals that will be spending next year working on bringing our systems, tying it all together and making sure that we have a system that works for our kids. So that's the work we're gonna continue doing in future years. And anytime we talk about mental health or social emotional being, suicide risk, I think it's always important we remind ourselves there are resources out there. Sometimes these discussions can trigger and make us think of someone we know who might be struggling, or if we need help or someone that we know needs help. So there are resources out there, and I think it's always good to share those. I'll just say this year has been especially tough. It's been great. We brought kids back 5 days a week, right? We have all of our kids back. But we needed to reteach those behavior expectations at PDIS. We had to reteach social skills. We needed to reteach some of those SEL skills. And on top of that, we're navigating a lot of mental health crisis with kids. So it has been a tough year. I think there is quite a bit of compassion fatigue or compassion burnout. And so making sure we take care of ourselves. And I thank the board for allowing us to go forward with some of our partnerships and also continuing to increase our allocation in student services so that we are able to meet the needs. So really, that's what I have for you today, what our team has, and we will take any additional questions if you have them. They're going to answer all of your questions.
Well, thank you, Chris, and all this staff. We really appreciate what you're doing and enlightening us in the process.
Any questions, Mark, Brian, Kat, or anyone while we have a group here?
I think one of the things that we've been talking about is kind of summit next fall, you know, to kind of help accelerate some of that conversation. Right? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, my thoughts, or would you like the groups? Anyone?
If I can open it up.
No, I think that's great. I mean, I think what Jack's talking about is he's brought an idea to a few of us, and I think he shared it at the last DEI meeting, was trying to create like a summit, a day, an event, an evening, afternoon, whatever that looks like, to bring some of our kind of groups of students and student leaders together and to kind of facilitate, have bring in some speakers. And I think it was kind of just to talk about kind of those, the importance of really a lot of the things we're talking about, connections, relationships, and looking at students from a kind of the diverse dynamics of our school and have them kind of working together and having dialogue and kind of having a structured process for that. But have it also in a place that is kind of has those things that engage kids that are trying to get them working together, get some things that are motivating, have food involved, all of those types of things. So that's kind of the concept I think we're looking at.
You know, making it like a cross-country meet
without the run.
Without the run.
And I would encourage any of you and encourage other staff, encourage students who approach you and said, you know, I have this concern. This is the, tell them to come here. It's not, I personally will ask our chair to, you know, if I have a question for a student or something outside of public comments, if we can incorporate a back and forth, but I think this is where it should be. And I encourage, tell them to come. I'd love to see students on a regular basis at this meeting. So.
One of the things that we have going to the board in June is our district priorities and goals. So I know that Joan Enslin, who's in back, is our board president, Ted Fry is our vice president. We met a week ago just to review what the priorities were from the board that they took away from the retreat this spring. And one of those things is focusing on the whole, the work of this, really this committee and the DEI committee, and putting forth some of the things that came out of the DEI ad hoc committee and making sure that those pieces have a voice at all of our other committees. But there was also a piece that the board did this year, and one of those recommendations is to continue the dialogue and connection with our students. And so that'll be a piece that'll be coming forward, and it'll be a discussion that we'll be having at our next board meeting. And I think, Jack, that's kind of where that discussion fits in, to kind of say is a general consensus to kind of move ahead with planning for some different ways that we can connect and bring kids together. That's really kind of where we're sitting.
Yeah, I think one of the thoughts is to bring business leaders in. If we do go forward with this event, you bring in business leaders. Because I think what we're trying to do is prepare our students for the real world. Right? And, you know, the same things, and I think Randy's brought it up several times, you know, what we're talking about business is exactly what we're trying to do here with the kids. And, you know, it's just a different language, but, you know, how do we get people working? And I think, you know, when you look at, you know, some of the training, the business comes back and says, you know, you're not training our kids. It's not, we're not training them in math and science, and reading and writing, and all that kind of stuff. It's, they don't have the social skills to work in the team when they hire for training. You know, it's a lot of team building, social skill development. So it's a thought.
Thank you all for being here tonight. That's really appreciated.
Thank you for having us. Thank you for being here.
Yeah, we have one more agenda item tonight.
I'll be here.
Next steps are.
So, as I look at work, I think we need to consider is one we have. We do not have a DEI mission statement. And I think that's work that should involve our committee along with a number of students, a number of parents, a number of staff, and without getting too big. But it's something that without that, I'm not sure it's really clear to our students or staff what the expectation is, that there are things embedded in certain statements about equity for all students and that sort of thing, but there's nothing that just stands out alone like that. And that's one of the things I heard from the student listening session, and somewhat from a couple of the comments made from staff. Well, where is the board? Where does the board stand on these things? Where does the district stand on these things? There's no statement that really embraces that concept.
Help me understand what these things are. Help me understand what these things are.
A mission statement?
no, you know, that they don't know how the board stands on what?
And diversity, equity, and inclusion.
I think there's sometimes a question about what are the things that we can discuss or not discuss, and to what level can some of those discussions take in a classroom across the district? I think that's part of what the dialogue is. And I would argue that it's a piece that starts with this, with a DEI statement or mission statement, but it has to go beyond that. I also believe it has to be a discussion that's a bit of a community-based discussion. It was kind of what we, in my mind, it was a piece we talked about at our community engagement piece this fall. And part of one of the next steps is trying to get folks together to kind of have some of these discussions. I think that would help us to get them better define what that statement is and give some guidance to our staff as well. There are some things I know that the CNI department has worked on that will be kind of continuing to finalize and forward at a point here to the curriculum committee to help with some of that as well. I think it may begin with some level of a statement, but it has to be broader than that, or it has to be more detailed than that.
Were you talking from the board standpoint?
I think that should be an item on our next committee. For this group, where do we go and how do we get it? Because it's, again, I can look at Middleton, some Prairie, Oregon, Monona Grove, Verona. There's a very definitive focus, and it's embraced by the board, and the students can see it, the teachers can see it. And so I think it's something that needs to be one of our top priorities and something that we start looking at our next meeting, if you're open to that. Another thing that I think we should be looking at is the recommendations from the former DEI that are our folk that were given to us. And I think that should be a bit, I don't know if we can fit all of that into the next agenda. I hope we could get some of it in, where we look at each of the items that was given to our committee and, okay, is this something that we're going to work on, and where does it fit into our plan? Is it something that was given to us to consider, but maybe we don't want it? Maybe we don't think it's a value. And there's about 15 of these that I think we need to figure out where's our focus and what aren't we gonna focus on? So to me, those would be two big things for the next agenda.
Okay, and I think those go together, Mark. I think the second one you had is something we need to do with all of our committees, is that's one of the goals that we'll have is to take those DEI ad hoc committee recommendations and they get parceled out to all of the committees that we have, this being one of them. And so that's actually a piece that will be on all of our committees, and hopefully we can move that forward in front of them all this summer.
Right.
So, but I think that it makes sense to do the next DEI committee that we have here to review the ones that are kind of owned by this committee. That makes sense.
Right. I think one of the things at our last meeting, you know, and you brought it up, is we wanted to have those those community listening sessions, you know, and that's probably early fall, you know, because everybody's off for summer vacation, and a lot of activity. And I think what it does is it gives us a couple months to plan that. And, you know, I think what that, if you have those listening sessions, that's going to drive your statement. You know, otherwise, what we're going to do is kind of put the statement together. We put the horse, you know, the cart before the horse. You know, that would be my thought.
Well, that's where.
So
I agree. I don't know. Normally, a group gets together to craft this, and that's why I felt the group needs to be students, parents, teachers, and board members, you know,
this committee member to try to put it together. If we want to have an engagement to talk about the values, kind of like we did in the cafeteria a bunch of years ago, and just be the focus, that would work out too. And then from there, the committee gets together with these representation to put it together. But again, I think that's something we don't need to hammer out tonight. That's, we're talking about agenda items for the next meeting. That might, that should be what we talk about.
So our next meeting agenda could be the recommendations from the DEI ad hoc committee that belong to this committee. The second one being really, how do we want to move forward with the development of a DEI statement,
right,
of which that encompasses what Jack is right, bringing up as far as what that process looks like. And those could be our two agenda items.
Yeah, well, I think we can't wait another 2 months. We've already kicked this one down a year.
Yeah. I'd like to see this
thing. I'd like to see it established by start of school.
Sure.
Yeah. And not wait for the community. I think we know what a good portion of the community thinks. You know, either you're for or against. So do we need to listen to all that again? Or I think we have a pretty good group that we could come up with a statement ourselves. Most statements aren't put together by 100 people.
No, no, it's a group.
It's a small group. And we've heard for a year or two on the DEI, and we had a great group at the ad hoc, and they got some great recommendations. I don't see that it's going to change the world, but I think we need one. But I don't think it's, we don't need to wait 3-4 months to come up with a final statement and wait.
We can come up with a statement, but I think I agree with Randy from the standpoint of what can we talk about, what can't we talk about. A statement's not gonna do that. You know, a statement says, you know, kind of a high level, you know, this is, you know, we're all supportive of DEI. I think we're supportive of it, but you know, I think what people are asking for is, what is the plan on how do we execute? You know, it's execution that we have to come up with. And how do we get diverse resources so that from all sides, everybody can, we're not gonna please everybody, but you know, at least we can compromise and say, these are the resources that that we want to move forward with.
Yeah, that's a good point. What I can do is forward to you guys some of the different district samples, and some Prairie and Verona are go much beyond the statement. I think Middleton does too, and I can get those sent out to you guys. That's, yes. Couple days or by next week.
If you want to shoot them to Rebecca and I, then we can share them out. If you want to send them to Rebecca,
sure,
then we can send them out.
Yep. Sounds good.
Yeah. And that'll be a piece that we can kind of fit into our next meeting.
Yep.
When would the committee like to meet again? You might as well, while we're here, just set the meeting. That works for you.
Can we do Monday nights, or does that work for you guys? Yeah. Monday nights?
Monday. We have 2 board meetings a month coming through, so yeah, we can look at Mondays.
Maybe our Tuesdays better, Wednesdays better.
It's a matter of adjustment.
Yeah. We got like things throughout the summer. So
we already have a Monday on the 13th is our board meeting. You could do the 20th. It's the next Monday we have another board meeting.
Does that work for you?
That works for me.
20th?
Yeah.
And we have to do 5:30 again?
5:30 looks great. Yep. Like I sort of mentioned, I mean, I would like to see if students want to come. I don't want it to be an incident. them to feel free about looking at the agenda and saying they have a comment about that.
Right.
You know, it's not the place to say this happened or that happened and stuff like that. But if they have ideas that they want to share, then I would like for that to be free flowing, as you know, to a limit, so it doesn't disrupt too much. But I think that they deserve that, or staff, or you know, but we'll take it as we go. We'll ask the chair for permission to have
we
that done.
We have Ann send out some kind of a preview before school's out, so for staff and students to see somehow. Like, we get the board summaries sent out to the public. Is there, I don't know if it gets,
you know, I think what you want to be careful with, I understand people come up here and make the public comments and so forth, but you know, if this gets into a situation where we got out of because, you know, people are thinking that this is going beyond this committee, you know, I want that input, yes, but you know, what we have to do is manage it so that the board committee is making the decisions,
yeah,
you know, going forward. And you know, I don't want to go into that slippery slope where we start, you know, making the community and the students and everybody, you know, it's a free-for-all type meeting. This is a board business meeting.
Right.
But we want their feedback and input. I'd rather have it here than go meet with a bunch of people round tables that are going to tell us the same thing we've heard for 2 years. I'm for it or I'm against it. You're doing this or you're doing that. They have an agenda. They don't have to look. Students won't go out on their own probably and look at it. But if there's something that they're passionate about, they can make a public comment.
Well, and at a committee meeting, we have the freedom to allow interaction with those who show up at the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And there can be a, I think, an open give and take, and then we close that, and then now we got to start where do we take this, that
right.
kind of thing.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just, yeah, it's not going to be, but if there's a one thing is
right.
discussion so yeah. regarding a good idea.
Exactly.
I don't want to cut them.
No, I agree. That's,
take their brain.
I don't want to treat it like a normal public comment thing. I think we should have, if we do legally have that flexibility as a committee to involve that. And I don't want to disregard that
right.
possibility.
And it won't be for the public to speak up first. It will be for us to initiate the question or to bring something back.
Okay.
Okay. That gives us our direction.
Great. Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Good.
Sorry, I was late for the meeting there.
Thank you.